I'm Shayne Gostisbehere, and you're watching Nasty Knuckles.
You're listening to Nasty Knuckles, the Hockey Outlaws podcast, with your host, Derek Nasty Suttermeyer, and former Philadelphia Flyer enforcer, Riley Cote, as they go behind the scenes with your favorite NHL players. Time to face off.
All right, welcome back. What's happening, Nasty?
What's up, Riggs? Got a little trimmy poo.
A little trimmy, just for you.
Not enough, no? But it's better. It's better. You don't look as primal.
No.
That's the word we want to use.
Woke up this morning, I was thinking about just how much shit you're going to give me about my
long
growth.
Beard. You look a little younger back today, yeah? Just because you did that. If you went down a little bit more, you're even younger. But you are a young man.
I thought I was in that it's extra like hour of rest old. I got last night.
Was it an extra hour?
Yeah.
So you went to bed at 7 instead of 8?
7:30.
Late night for you.
Yeah.
You weren't watching the games? Some good games?
No, I was just get the highlights.
Just the highsies?
Yeah.
Well, we didn't have men's league last week because it was Easter.
Mm-hmm.
And you have yet to make a game, but we have one this weekend, so I'm sure Easter you'll be hunt. There. Easter egg hunt. Well, we didn't have a game. It was no games on Easter. But since we last were here with a big bird last week, Flyers have lost three straight, one in overtime, grabbing a point, which could turn out to be an important point. But a couple games I thought that they need to win all their games. But, you know, going into Montreal, it's not easy to play there, but tough game, 4-1 loss. Didn't seem to have that energy. I don't know. It's just, you know, one of those games. But then coming home to play the Blackhawks, losing 5-1, that was really tough one. Fought the other night against the Islanders team. You know, you're hoping we can beat them to kind of push them a little bit further back, but I ended up losing in overtime. But we did see Ivan Fedotov,
mm-hmm.
who got his came in the second period in relief of Ersson. And what'd you think of the big fella?
Well, he's huge.
He is a
that's
big
for
man.
Sure. I liked what I saw. I mean, he makes that net look really small.
He does, and
fills it out nicely.
He's very quick.
He's quick
as well for a guy that big. Yeah, I was watching him just specifically, like watching him mm-hmm. move, and it's kind of funny, like how some goalies have to kind of fight to see at the point when there's someone in that. He's just like this. He's standing over looking, but like he dropped quick. Like,
yeah.
Good athlete, obviously. Mm-hmm. He was there years when I was still with the team. He had come to, I think it was development camp, may have been main camp, but anyway, felt bad for Sam.
Yeah,
you know, he's played a lot of hockey lately, and you know. I don't know, but it was kind of cool to see Feds get in there. First shot in NHL is Barzal coming on a breakaway.
Right,
hey, welcome
how
to the league,
doing?
But he you know, made the save and he had a good second period. The goalie did get on him in the second was deflected. So I don't, you know, not much he could do there, but
he was, well, according to Torts, but obviously according to the old eye test, the only guy that showed up in the second there and gave him a standing chance.
Yeah.
Obviously rallied in the third, which you always like to see, the resilience. But yeah, we talked about this last week. It's crunch time and these lower end teams you have to find a way to beat. So obviously Chicago, and it was even more heart-wrenching.
Yeah.
And going into Montreal, these teams aren't going to make it easy on the Flyers.
Right.
You know, looking at it on paper, be like, oh, these teams are below you. You should beat these guys. They're playing spoiler. They're playing for contracts next year. Rosters
exactly.
And all that good stuff. So it's going to be a grind, right? It's going to be right to the last game of the season. I can assure you that.
It's
tight.
You're right, and it's amazing. I was looking, Baller can throw up the standings, but You just lost three straight. I know you got 1 point, but like how they're still in that spot is crazy.
It is.
With 83 points, and you've got Washington with two games at hand at 82 points,
mm-hmm.
which kind of scares me because they've gotten hot. Ovi's hot.
Right.
As Baller was telling me, he blacked out his old sticks and
he's feeling
if he was using a Tovey, he'd have had 50 by now. I'm just saying.
Guaranteed.
But he is hot in all seriousness, and Detroit, you know, they have 82 points with a game at hand. So the Flyboys really, we got to win some games here coming down the stretch. And the Islanders are there too. They have 81 points with a game at hand. So
And Pitt even kind of
even Pitt, yeah,
making a small creep there.
Yep, 79 points. They're only four behind. They do have a game at hand, but you just never. You don't want to. Well, I don't think they're going to get in Pitt, but like God, I Crosby, Malkin, like you just don't know. I mean, you never know what's going to happen. That's what makes I love this time of year where it's especially on this side. The West is a little different. You basically have all your teams in there, except St. Louis is trying to catch the Kings. They're 3 points back of them for that last wild card spot. But I love these games now on the East because they all mean something. Well, most of these games mean something, and especially for the Flyers, if you just can win, you'll be okay, and you don't have to worry about everyone else, but you got to win.
Well, that's it. That's always the key.
So that's all it is?
That is
no, but the formula, you know, you spoke about it. You spoke about it earlier as we've been going through the year and talking about how hard these guys work. It's hard to do for 82 games, and, you're almost seeing, and even Torts, I said the other night, you just can't practice. Because you're playing 3 to 4 games a week, and I know everyone is, but all these other teams they don't have to play like the Flyers have to play to win games, as we know. And God, you know, if we could just get the power play going a little bit, can you imagine where squeezing you might have a few more points,
for sure,
you know, in there. But it's going to be interesting, man, and it does makes the games fun, and it's more fun to watch, and I'm glad they're in it. I just hope we can find a way to sneak in here.
Yeah, no doubt. And going on the road, Buffalo, Columbus, like clearly must win games.
Yes.
I mean, if you drop those two, I mean, or one of those two, it's not ideal. You know, like you said, like you have to essentially go to win every game the rest of the year just to control your own fate. But as you know, you drop one or two of the other teams are winning, and then all of a sudden
and they have games at hand.
Games in hand. So, yeah, I mean, they have to, as we all know, they all know in the locker room that Friday night in Buffalo.
Big game.
Like A-plus, A-plus game. Like, you know, there's no other way around it. And then doing it all over again the next night in Columbus. Yeah, I mean,
no. And that's a tough place to play all the time.
It is,
Doesn't matter where they are in the standings. We've always had a tough time in there. It's just one of those buildings, man.
Yeah.
Is your boy Provy going to play spoiler?
You know he wants to.
Yeah, well, exactly. You both those teams want to.
Yeah, I mean, well, who does
Buffalo coming in, you know, they want to spoil the Flyers. Columbus, Flyers coming in, they want to.
Yeah.
You know that. I mean, this is just the way it is. I mean, there's certainly no easy games. There's never been any easy games.
No.
You might catch a team on an off night.
Right.
But right now, these teams are probably bearing down more than ever just to give the Flyers a squeeze, or anybody for that matter.
For sure.
But it'll be interesting.
It'll be interesting. And it was good to see Drysdale back in the lineup. Unfortunately, Coots goes down in the corner.
Yeah.
I think Baller was saying he's day-to-day. Obviously, it looked like an apparent shoulder injury when you go into the boards. Shoulder first.
Yeah.
I'm sure they would say upper body, but hopefully he's going to be okay day-to-day. Hopefully Coots can... I saw him play years back in the playoffs when him and Goody, I don't know if you remember, ran into each other. But I remember that in practice, just doing a normal drill. And the kid played. I think he had a hat trick, actually. but, you know, if Coots can play, he's going to play.
Yeah.
All these guys would. Also, Risto, we don't really know where he is. So they had said a while back, day to day, but...
AKA month to month.
Yeah, it might be month to month. I'm not sure what's going on there.
Just joking.
But nice to see Drysdale back.
Yeah.
Hopefully, Coots is going to be okay. But got to win some games, bud.
Yeah.
On the West, like I said, it's not the – your boys in Winnipeg are limping a little bit. 4-5-1.
A little limp.
But it's not the cool limp.
You want to be hobbling into the playoffs.
It ain't the strut.
Yeah,
it's a limp.
It's definitely not the swagger.
4-5-1 in their last 10. They're going to make the playoffs. Not like they're going to make it, but you don't – want to be going into the playoffs not playing well.
That's right.
And the only other thing I could, you know, like I said, on the West side is St. Louis has creeped into like 3 points behind LA, but it's going to be tough for them to get in.
Yeah.
And the only other thing is Edmonton's only five back of Vancouver. But, I mean, you know, with two games at hand, But other than that, man, it's the East that's the most interesting.
Yeah. Yeah, you feel the squeeze, feel that playoff hockey.
Yeah, it's the best time of year for me.
Yeah, I mean, as a fan, you like to see it right to crunch time, yeah. The squeeze, and all these teams right there in the mix. It just makes it more enjoyable. You've seen playoff games in real time.
Yeah.
Pre-playoff, so I wish the Flyers the best on this road trip.
I know, we got to do it here. We got to do it here. One other thing in the East, Carolina's pretty hot, buddy. Oh. They're hot right now.
They're sizzling.
Get old Koozie, the bird.
The bird.
And Jake Guentzel.
Great additions.
Yeah, they've snuck up. They're only three behind the Rangers, but Lavi's got them going. So mm-hmm. We'll see. It'll be interesting down the stretch here.
Hopefully it will be. I think we're ready to ask.
You ready?
152?
152 with old number 53.
Old number 53. Ghost.
Ghost. Shayne Gostisbehere, brother. Yeah.
Let's go. Nasty, you get your AG1s in you today?
I sure did. Every morning, that's how I start my day. Never feel sluggish anymore.
Looking pretty chipper.
I'll tell you what, definitely feel more focused, never sluggish anymore since I started drinking the AG1. It's my favorite way to start the day, brother.
Great way to start the day, replacing those garbage multivitamins with AG1. Get your prebiotics, probiotics. Support your digestive enzymes and gut support. It's got it all.
Sure does, brother.
Nas, would you recommend this to our listeners?
100%. I would recommend it. As I said, the feeling, the difference in the way I feel in the mornings after drinking AG1 is unbelievable. And I noticed it within a couple of days.
And I'd like to mention that it is tested for over 950 contaminants and is NSF certified for sport. So anybody worried about getting drug tested out there,
right?
It is safe. Nas, if there's one product we'd like to recommend to our listeners, it's AG1. That's why we're excited to have them as an amazing partner.
You're right, Riggs. If you want to take ownership of your health, it definitely starts with AG1. Try AG1 and get a free one-year supply of vitamin D3, K2, and 5 free AG1 travel packs with your first purchase at drinkag1.com/knuckles. That's drinkag1.com/knuckles. Please check it out.
Let's go. Welcome back. I'm Riley Cote.
And I'm Derek Settlemyer. This week, we are super jacked to have a good friend of the show, good friend of ours. Back in 2012, Riles, he was drafted by the Flyers, 78th overall in the third round. He spent 6 seasons with the Orange and Black, currently on the heels of the Flyers, playing in Detroit. First in assist on the team, 4th in points. This guy runs the point like nobody else on defense. Our good friend, Ghost Shayne Gostisbehere. What's up, brother?
What's up, boys? How's it going?
Doing all right, man. You got a lot of shit going on at home there today.
Crazy. Heat broken, agent calling. I don't know what's going
on. Oh, man. We appreciate you jumping on with us, man.
Yeah, no doubt. Nice to see you.
Yeah, it's nice to see you. Nice to see you, brother. So we're just talking about it before we started here, man. It's a tight race right now, boys, in the East, and you guys are coming hard.
Tight, man, tight. I mean, I don't know what's going on. Who wants it? We're losing. Everyone's losing, but you know, it's good to play some meaningful hockey at this time of year. So yeah. It's been awesome.
For sure, man. That's you guys are definitely making it interesting. It looked a few weeks ago like you guys were really rolling, and then I think Larkin was out of the lineup for a little bit, and you kind of dropped a few. I'm like, oh boy, now it's really, 6-7 games left. I think you guys have a game in hand, if I'm not mistaken, on the Flyers. And what are you, 1 point back from them?
Yeah, I think we're 1 point. They had a tie with 9 seconds there the other night. So
yeah, I know, right?
No, it's good. I mean, like I said, it's cool to play meaningful hockey right now. I mean, it's good for us to have Larks. I mean, he's driving the bus for us. You can see without him, we're not at our best. So having him and him just leading the way and us just, playing behind him, obviously, just helps us, get there for, whatever's up these last 6 games. So, it's going to be fun.
Yeah, for sure.
I haven't taken a great look at your guys' schedule, but, last week we were talking about the Flyers schedule. I think 7 out of the 8 games were against lower teams. And, you look on paper, it'd be like, oh, they got a easy schedule and they've dropped 3 of those.
They dropped all 3 last year. It's
almost like opposite. Like we're playing wagons right now. We just had the gauntlet of the road trip of the Atlantic, Carolina, Yeah. We had Nashville. They were rolling right into Tampa and Florida. And it's just like, oh my God. And then we're playing the Rangers on Friday, I think. And it's just like, mm-hmm. Jesus. But, you know, it's good to play those teams that, you know, sometimes it's harder against those, you know, those lower end teams that, you know, they're playing, they have nothing to lose. They're playing free, you know, so it's just different. It's a different game when you're playing those teams. So it just all depends.
They want to be spoilers anytime you're playing teams like that. You got sometimes you have guys playing for contracts, and so you're exactly right. But it's good. We were talking about on the pre-show. It's so much fun right now with all in the East. The West is different, but the East, all there's like four of you guys. These teams just right there fight for that spot. So meaningful hockey, like you said, it's a lot of fun to watch.
Well, what goes on in the locker room as far as like any sort of shift in game plan, or is this just like keeping it simple and just everyone knows what they need to do? Like what is it even to talk about?
I think it's just making all these guys realize like every play matters right now. I mean, you know, when you don't block a shot, you're 10 games in, they score and you lose by one. You know, when you're 10 games, it's a lot different when, you know, you have 7 games left and you're tied for the wild card spot. I mean, it's just every little thing matters right now. Every board battle, every chip out, anything, you know, it all matters right now. I think that's what we're really trying to harp with our group. And, you know, especially these guys who haven't experienced this and, you know, like we said, the meaningful hockey thing. And, you know, I've been on, you know, I think with the Flyers, we got in maybe one game left or 2 games left. We got in, I think G had like a hat trick against the Rangers and I think it was like his 100th point as well. It was like such a big game. Then we had like one game left to like breathe a little, but you know, just for those guys who haven't been in this position, you know, just making them realize, you know, every little thing matters right now.
Yeah, I was going to say, Ghost, you've been on some really big stages, actually. I mean, we can get into that a little bit, but winning a national championship in the center, actually, which was cool. And you've played some playoff hockey as well. And last year, you were in Carolina, and you guys had a really good team. You went on a bit of a run there. So the younger guys, it's probably really good to get. It's like the Flyers, if they get in, they have so many young players. It'd be really good experience. You've played playoff hockey in Philly, you know, it's pretty cool. But you're right, man. You gotta, every play matters, man.
Yeah. I don't think the average fan understands like how critical of a statement that is.
Yeah. You know, this time of year, it's just obviously different. You know, it leads right into playoff hockey too. I mean, some of these guys who've never played playoff hockey, they're going to be obviously shocked in the sense of like what it's just a completely different game from the regular season.
Yeah, it is. It's like, it's so wild too. When you get into the playoffs, it's like you've had an 82 game season, but then you get into playoffs and it's like, everybody's up another gear now.
Yeah.
And you didn't think it could get faster or harder, but it does for sure.
Yeah, definitely tighter.
How are you enjoying Detroit? How's it been?
I love it, man. I mean, you know, obviously you're close to, you know, Haddonfield, Voorhees area. Like that's kind of what we have here. I mean, you have your downtown Detroit and then we have the suburbs here. It's like Bloomfield Hills, Birmingham. And, you know, it's been awesome. I mean, Gene and I are really, you know, loving it. Or even our dogs like it, maybe not the snow as much, but I mean, it's been great in the sense that, you know, the community's great. I mean, you're on original 16. I mean, you can't beat that. And, you know, you can feel the buzz in the area and the town. I mean, every time you go out, you know, people are just so excited for us and maybe not as hard as on us as Philly, but, you know,
it's, really, it's not,
it's just a different kind of passion, Philly. I mean, anyone who played for them realizes, you know, Philly's Philly. And, you know, I think obviously just being on an original 16 that hasn't been in the playoffs for almost a decade now, and, you know, we're getting a sniff of it right now. It's pretty cool to see the buzz in the air.
Awesome. You know, something I just popped in my head quickly. How cool is it to like work for Steve Yzerman?
It's cool for sure. I mean, haven't had many conversations with him, but you know, he's got that intimidation factor too, but he's also the nicest guy in the world. Every time I see him, he always asks if my family needs anything or if we're doing okay. And it's just cool to see that side, but you know, you can see, you know, maybe that little electric side that you want to stay away from. So he's got that, you know, that intimidation factor. And obviously, you know, him just being such a legend, just seeing how much, the way he walks around the rink, how much, you know, just everyone's just on edge just a little bit. Like, you know, obviously he's a great guy too.
He's one of those guys, like the way he carries himself. Yeah, he's just got that presence, right?
Yeah,
it's
like, yeah, exactly.
Stevie
exactly.
Y, man.
I think I told his story goes before, but quickly, while I was doing a world championship, I think it was when we were in Moscow. It was back in like 2008, I think. I believe he was the GM of Team Canada, and a bunch of our guys from US brought jerseys for him to sign. And we were coming off of the ice, and Canada's room was just beside ours, and Stevie Eisenman was standing in the hallway, and a couple of the guys were like, "Hey, Mr. Eisenman, like, you mind signing a jersey?" And they were bringing them to the rink and leaving them in their stall. And he goes, "Boys, you got a game. Let's worry about your game. I'll sign your jersey." It's kind of funny. He's laughing, and I'm like, I'm putting gloves on the dryer, and I was just like, "I want an autograph too, bro."
Of course, yeah.
He seems like a great guy. I actually met him a few times, and I just wanted to ask you that real quick, because he, like you said, he's a legend, man. He's such a good player.
Well, and piggybacking off that, I mean, a little different animal, but playing with Patrick Kane, I mean, obviously one of the best American-born players, Skillsy. What's Showtime. That been like?
Showtime, baby.
I mean, it's pretty cool. I mean, I've played with some pretty good players, but, you know, when you have the best American-born player, being American too, and playing in the video games with him when he comes in, pretty cool, man. I'm not gonna lie. I mean, I think the most surprising part is how down to earth and simple and easy and cool he is. I mean, it was just funny. It was like we were his first skate with us. He met us in New York. We were at MSG, and he had to like practice for a week. He hadn't practiced with the team for a bit, and I remember. I didn't skate. It was an optional. I'm never skating an optional. But I remember like me and like five guys, we like ran out. You know how it's like a little bit of a walk at MSG bench. Yeah. So we're like in the tunnel, just like seeing him put on the gear for the first time and just get out there. And we're like, that's pretty sick. It's first time.
He just looks cool, right? Yeah. Like,
let's go stick handle or something.
Yeah, I know. Right? Those middies, man.
Yeah. I mean, you can just see it. I mean, like the plays he makes, you know, like, it's just insane. Like on the power play, like I played with him a few times, just like he like paralyzes penalty kills. Like they're just like watching him and like, you know what he's going to do. He still does it and puts it like right on someone's tape backdoor empty net. It's just like, it's incredible to see him just still have the game. I mean, just to, you know, obviously the injury he's been through and whatnot, there's not a lot of obvious success with other guys getting it, and seeing him do his thing, still be a point per game guy, and pretty awesome.
Yeah. How cool was it in Chicago when he got that G done?
Dude, that was nuts. I mean, I was expecting something like sick like that, but like number one, like Chelly's jersey retirement. Ceremony, that was unreal. Like Chelly's an unreal guy, and his like charisma and everything is just and like it started then, like when he shouted out Kaner. Kaner was on the bench, and I was like two people down from Kaner, and I was like, the place was like, you saw it on TV, but like being in the building was like that much more electric. Oh. And then like storybook, like he scores the OT winner. Like, are you kidding me? And then like his,
it's showtime.
He does like a lap, and like, another fishy was like, give him another lap. And he just like kept going in a circle, like, give him another one. Like, just get on him. And it was so sick. I remember we got back from, thank God we won. I mean, Kaner OT winner, storybook. But I remember we got back like 3 a.m. or 2:30 in the morning. And then like fishies from Chicago, he texts me, he goes, did that fucking happen, man? I was like, dude, that was like so storybook. That was so sick.
I came off the couch, man. I was just so cool, man. I was actually thinking about you too. Like how cool that is that you're there seeing that.
Yeah, it was so awesome. Just to be a part of like, you know, Kaner, him giving me pass, I'm giving Kaner a couple backdoors, you know. It's just like, what is life? What's going on? But that was so sick. That was something. Probably the coolest part of my career so far, like just being there for that, just seeing like the crowd take him in, like everything. Even Chelly's jersey retirement was so sick. Like that was unreal.
You would have thought Chicago scored. You knew they were going to go nuts if he scored, but like that was, like you said, a storybook ending. That was unbelievable. I wanted to go back, like, so you're from Florida. I mean, most people know that, but like, if you want to just talk quickly about how you got started playing hockey, I kind of know, but like a lot of people don't.
Yeah. I grew up in Florida. My grandpa, my mom's side, he's actually from Montreal. He moved to Florida when he was like 15, but there was no hockey back then yet in South Florida. So the moment, obviously, my mom had a boy, I was had skates on my feet right away. I think I was like 3 years old when he got me on the ice, and luckily my sister, she's like 3 years older than me. She was like a very high level figure skater, national level. She was an Olympic hopeful, but she had some bad hip issues and she unfortunately had to stop. But I was always at the rink as a kid because of my sister too. So my mom would give me a stick and I would have a puck and I would just stick handle around like what LB does at the rink and stuff.
Yeah, yeah.
My mom would just say, don't just stay out of trouble. And most of the time I did, but yeah. And I just got into hockey from there and then, you know, luckily started travel hockey. And then one of my first AAA coaches was Ray Shepard. So like we had a bunch of, cause it's Florida, like bunch
yeah.
of more NHLers are retired there. And he ended up being our coach. He was our coach for about like 4 years. And he showed us like what AAA hockey is. We were going to tournaments like twice a month. I don't know how my parents afforded that, by the way, but like insane. Like we were like mini pros pretty much. We would leave, right. miss some school. Other than that, like we would just, he would just, you know, get us to the best competition to show us like what it takes to play hockey, like in the world. You could be the best in Florida. It's pretty easy, but you guys need to go play with some of the big boys, get into Canada, do those tournaments and stuff. So, you know, that was great. And then, I actually wanted to go to boarding school. I actually went to Stoneman Douglas, that school in Florida for about 2 years. And then I left for my junior and senior year and I went to boarding school. And that's where I went to South Kent. And South Kent. Before it turned into that like Selects Academy where Beezer, you know, went and stuff. It was just prep. I stayed there for 2 years, my junior, senior year of high school. And then actually my junior year, that's when I started getting some looks for Division One. And then Union came calling. It was actually my first offer and I fell in love with the school. It was a small town school and it's only 2,200 kids. And, you know, I said, I committed right there, right? Like it was junior year. So I had a whole nother year of high school. And then I was literally like 150 pounds, like 17 year old. And I was like, I'm going to go play juniors probably for 3 years. Thing, be a beauty.
Yeah. But, yeah.
Coach called me. He's like, yeah, I want you on campus in fall. I was like, what? I'm like, wow. Not even 18 yet. And he's like, yeah, I want you there now. You're going to be probably the only one who's done this in a while for our school. And I was like, okay. My mom was like, fuck no. But, you know, it was cool. It was cool to just be, you know, kid from Florida, just trying to make it. And then I went to Union and, you know, had some success there. And then after my freshman year, I got passed over my first year draft eligible to 2011. And then, you know, had some good meetings. My best meeting was with the Flyers and John Riley came to Union, had a meeting at a local bagel shop. And we just sat there, chopped it up. And then I heard my name called 78th overall. So it was pretty cool.
Wow.
Yeah. I was going to ask you, you kind of explained it about like what drew you to Union, but, I was going to say like, you guys win a national championship and, you know, beat Minnesota, I think 7-4. I think you had a hand in every single goal that night. You ended up being the Frozen Four MVP. Not a big deal. Mm-hmm. But what I was going to ask you is like, your team wasn't like overly stacked, like with a bunch of NHL players like yourself, but what was it about that team that you guys were, you know, so good, just played well together?
Yeah, I mean, we just had like a good combination of everything. You know, we weren't the best at one thing, but we were good at everything. And our coach was just, he knew how to get us going. I mean, from my freshman year to my junior year when we won. My freshman year, we made it to the Frozen Four. It was the first time our school had a lot of success in the tournament. But it was a more like a happy to be here sort of thing. Like, look, we did it. Like, we made it. But like, by the time, the third time, or my junior year when we got there, it's like, no, we're here to win now. So, you know, like I said, it was a blend of everything. You know, we didn't have the, you know, the first rounders or anything. I think I was the only draft pick at the time. And, you know, for us, we knew what type of team we had. We knew what it took to, you know, win. And, you know, we just went out there and did it. And it was pretty cool. I mean, I think it's the 10-year anniversary of it this year. And I know my school's doing some big things in the summer for it, but you know, it's definitely a special moment in my career for sure.
Yeah, it's so cool. And I was going to ask you, I don't know how much you pay attention to college hockey still, but like with the whole transfer portal and the deals you could get, the NIL deals you could get, sponsorships for the athletes. It's really changed like college sports. It, you know, not only hockey, obviously every sport, but do you think it's going to, that's going to like hinder like smaller schools like Union?
Yeah. So I could see it already happening. Cause at the time when I was there, we didn't have scholarships. We just had financial aid. And I remember like 3 years ago, there was like this big committee put together just to say like, what can we do for the program to, you know, the landscape of college hockey has completely changed, college sports in general, just, and they said, we need scholarships. And there was a fund put together for them to have scholarships. And I think this past year, the next year, there's going to be the first year they're using these scholarships. And because it's just so crazy. I remember there was a good player on our team. His name, Daniel Champion. He was actually in my class. I remember his freshman year, he played like six games. And if that's today's world, he's transferring.
He's
like,
leaving.
Yeah, right.
Yeah.
He's leaving right away. I mean, he ends up scoring almost 80 goals throughout his career in college. And thankfully he obviously stayed at Union and was a big part why we won, but it's just different, man. I don't know how coaches deal with it, but I mean, you got to obviously survive and adapt, modernize.
Mm-hmm. It's funny because like, in, you know, I didn't play Division I level, I played Division II, but like when you're in college before, I don't want to say they own you like in a bad way, but they own you in college. Yeah. Now, you said,
yeah,
you piss a kid off. I mean, the wrong kid. Yep. Like some coaches are trying to teach you, right? And some people can't handle that.
That's right.
And you know, you probably have to walk a tighter rope there, like as a coach, to so you don't lose guys because they can just leave now.
Yeah, I'd have to agree.
But anyway, yeah, you win the national championship, then you come back with the gold medal in World Juniors. That had to be like unbelievable.
Yeah, I mean, that was another like really cool experience. I don't think I was ever on the radar for that. And then just having a good freshman and sophomore year, and then you get invited to that summer camp in the summer, and I actually did like really good. I scored like three goals in like four of the scrimmages, and you know, just to make that team was like awesome. And I remember our team at the time, we weren't really picked to go far, but like if you look at that team now, like every guy's played in the NHL.
Yeah.
Guys are superstars, and it's just like, it was really cool to be a part of. It was a great experience too. And you know, we were in Ufa, Russia. It wasn't the best spot. But it was all worth it once you come home with that medal around your neck, coming back to school.
Yeah,
I forgot. That was before. It was a year before you won a national championship.
Yeah.
But man, two pretty good years there.
Pretty good years.
Yeah, it wasn't bad.
Yeah, right.
Not bad.
Hey, Ghost, I gotta ask you, like, when did you really kind of come into your own and have like that breakthrough year? Is it before college? Like, when did you like realize you were like that dynamic of a player? Did it take some time?
I honestly didn't realize until like my freshman year when I got to school, like my coach sat me down. He's like, hey, you're going to be on the power play. You're going to do this. And I was just like, what? Like, I wasn't expecting anything when I got to school. I was 18 years old. I didn't know anything. He's like, yeah, you're on the first unit. You're going to run this, like you're dynamic. Just go do your thing. Like for sure. There was growing pains for sure. And just as my freshman year progressed, I realized like, I was like, wow, like I'm doing really good. Like, and then like all these NHL teams start coming to school to like have these meetings because I'm draft eligible. And I'm just like, wow, like I really have a shot here. But my ultimate goal was just to play Division I hockey, like as a hockey player growing up in Florida. And, you know, things just progress from that. And, you know, I'm definitely thankful for my journey. It's unique in the sense that, you know, I'm from Florida and whatnot, but just to play college hockey and get all those opportunities and for it to come to you when you're not like a highly touted kid, you know. And thankfully it's led me to have a, you know, a blessed NHL career and hopefully still going. So
yeah,
for sure. Know, it's been awesome.
That's wild. So you were obviously a good hockey player, but you really didn't realize how good you were until essentially what you're saying.
Yeah, I honestly had no idea. I mean, I was
amazing.
Oblivious to it in the sense that, you know, thankfully my parents didn't let me grow up with a big head or anything and just, you know, go out and have fun and play hockey and see how far this thing could take you.
Wow. Well, you're 612 games into the NHL. And you got plenty more to go here. Three goals away from a hundo, Riggs.
Yeah, I know.
That'd be 99 more than you buried.
Yeah.
But that's 100 more than I buried.
Oh, man.
it's amazing, man. Just like we said, two back-to-back years winning some pretty big tournaments there. I wanted to ask you real quick. We were both there together. You were on a different team, but the 2016 World Cup, you played on Team North America, which we all called the Young Guns, man. That You guys were so excited. I was there with USA. We didn't win a damn game. It was torts. It was tough, man. It started out so great that the week before, you know, like we did all right in the pre-tournament games, and then it just went quick. But I was able. I saw a couple times you guys played. I actually just went back to the rink and watched because I think I remember talking to you, and it was some of the fastest hockey I'd ever seen, man. Your team.
The practices, I was like, I remember I was looking at Coots and I'm like, these practices are a fucking joke, right? Like, they were the hardest things ever because everyone was just flying around.
Yeah.
It's just crazy. Yeah. I mean, more for Coots keeping up with that. But you know, it was a unreal experience in the sense that, I don't know, it hasn't been done since, you know, hopefully they bring that back. Because, like, that experience for us just, you know, obviously – putting the two teams together in the sense of Canada, US, and, you know, just letting these young guns, like you said,
that was awesome, man.
Have at it. And it would be really cool to see today because just how much
wouldn't it
since then, like in that short amount of period, but like it would be really awesome.
I thought what was so cool about that team and everybody was calling you guys the young guns was just because like you really don't have anything to lose because you're younger than for everyone sure. else that's playing, but yet so talented.
Yeah.
And I wish they like did the tournament different. Like we went 2-1 in the group stage. Like you think you would like move on.
I know.
You're like, damn, like give the people what they want to see. They
want
to
see exactly. And you know? I remember seeing, I think was Nathan McKenna, like you guys won the one game, the last game you played, right? You won in overtime.
Yeah, we won against Sweden in overtime. Yeah.
And someone he was doing a post game like right after. And
yeah, we thought we were in.
I know, and he said that.
We thought we won the cup. We thought we were in.
I know, and the lady doing interviews like, well, you gotta this has to happen. He's like, what? We're not in? Not yet. And I was like, oh, I feel so bad for him, man.
Yeah, like you go 2-1, and you tie one of the games or whatever. I don't even remember what really happened, but I thought we were in for sure.
Yeah, I did too. I had a great time, even though we didn't do well, but it was fun. It was fun watching that hockey. It was a lot of fun. Hopefully they bring that back.
Yeah.
Hey, Ghost, I got to ask you, your first taste of pro hockey in the American League, Adirondack Phantoms. how was that transitioning out of some success?
Who was my first D coach again?
I thought it was only like two games.
No, man, it was more than two.
In Adirondack?
I played two games like for that, but then next year.
Yeah, the next year, yeah.
I started in the minors. Riles was still kicking back there.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
Oh, yeah. Cool. I remember that. I know we had we went for a training camp. We went down to with the Lehigh for a game.
Yep.
Guess whose skates weren't there? And I got to take the blame because I was in charge.
You lost them.
So I was like, no, I forget exactly what happened, but we had a new pair, and I'm like, Ghost, I gotta tell you something, bud.
Nasty came up to me like almost crying. He's like,
I felt so sorry. The guy's trying
never
to
never happen again.
I'm like,
what? He's like, we forgot your skates. I was like, what?
I thought
second preseason game. I'm like,
I know,
trying to make the team.
I thought the guy that was working with me was kidding. Like, I thought he was just messing around. He's like, no, they're
so how'd that play out?
Well, he put new skates on and played his poor guy's feet. We're killing him, and he still looked great. He still played awesome.
Fresh wheels,
but he doesn't like. Well, I don't know if you've changed since I had you, but he didn't really like getting into you and G. It was like pulling teeth to get these guys into new skates.
Still like maybe two pairs a year.
That blows my mind away. Then I got Proby changing every 3 to 4 games. Jake, he could go one game and want to change.
That's really putting someone in a squeeze though when you forget their skates and actually force them to put in new wheels.
Second preseason game, he's trying to make a squad. He has no skates. I told the coaches, I told them all, I'm like, look, this is the deal. And they're like, oh fuck, here we go. You're fired. Now that came a couple years later.
Yeah, right.
your rookie season, Ghost, man, 17 G's. I swear to God, every time he took a 1T, it was going in. Like it was unbelievable. That must have been a
magic back. I haven't had that feeling since.
Oh my God, man. It was crazy. It was so awesome and it pushed us through. I mean, we won so many games in overtime. I went back and was looking at clips on YouTube. I just remember how pumped I would be and the whole team.
That was like one of the most exciting.
It was so exciting
moments, or like, you know, it was a 2 or 3 month span, I guess, right? Or whatever it was.
Crazy.
Like, it was amazing.
That was fun. That was a ride for sure.
Yeah. And I ended up being second in Calder voting that year. And you really 2017, 2018, I had an incredible 65 points that year, man. It was 52 assists that year. It was crazy, man. But just that one tee, boom,
the one tee
in the net.
Yeah. When did you really unlock that bad boy? Was that the same time that you kind of got thrown back on the power play there? Or is,
I don't know.
Realizing you had that thing in your back pocket.
Nasty knows that, but I don't know. My grandpa always told me, he's like, you're going to shoot, man. Shoot as fucking hard as you can. I'm like,
yeah. Great advice. Yeah.
Yeah. Good mechanics, I guess.
Yeah. I mean, I'm assuming that your golf swing's pretty legit.
Oh, yeah. He's not a bad golfer.
Yes, you know.
Little better than you.
Little better than mine, yeah.
Hey, I was telling a story, Ghost, the other day. It was you and I, and we took Stoli. It was right when he first, like, wanted to play golf. Stoli's huge, mm-hmm. right? So he wasn't that, like, he wasn't doing that bad, but there was someone else with us. It was another young guy. And like, Ghost is like, for you guys that don't know, he's a sick golfer, like ridiculous. And so I suck, but I'm like trying to at least, I play fast. At least if I hit a bad shot, I'm pretty quick. But I remember him and I tee off, and I just cannot remember who the other guy was, but him and I are like in the fairway waiting, and we start looking around. Where the fuck these two guys go? And they were in a different card. Him and I were riding together. Stoli and whoever it was over looking for balls in the bushes. And you were like, what are you doing?
We don't look for balls.
There's people behind us. Like, and they're like over, like trying to
get some free balls.
Yeah. Trying to find like not their ball. Like,
not theirs. Like free balls.
They're trying to load up their cart. Like, look how many balls we found.
Not why we're here, boys. Like, fucking.
Totally, I've been guilty of that.
It was so funny. You were with me when I got Sammy with the snake that day too.
Oh yeah. I was with you. That was at Woodcrest, I think.
Yeah, that was at Woodcrest. Yeah. I got Stoli really good with it, but my damn double hit the record. I didn't get the footage. I didn't get it. But
Sammy was good though. Sammy like screamed and
I could just see that look on Sammy's face.
He lost his mind, man. wanted to ask you, like, quickly going back last year, you go to Carolina, my home state. How'd you like Rod Brind'Amour playing for Roddy?
Roddy was awesome. I mean, just the organization as a whole, you know, I really love those guys just in the sense that they were so easy to like just drag you in the fight, you know, like you get there at the deadline. It's a little different. I've never experienced that before. I mean, I've been traded, but not mid season. So it was just different. But like from day one, I felt like I've been there for like a while, and it was awesome. I mean, I hope those guys go far, man, because they really deserve it. They built something pretty special there. You know, it was a lot of fun. And, you know, Rod is the best coach, man. He really is. He could get you going, man. He can make you go to war, as they would say. But, you know, they got it going there, man. They made some good additions too. So, you know, I'm pretty mm-hmm. pumped for them.
Yeah. They're fun to watch. Boy, they're fast. They play fast.
Oh, the system, man. They're just like, they strap you down, dude. They lock it down, man. They're so good.
I love when they show Roddy. Like I'm so old. I had I'm not that old. No, but I'm so old. I had Roddy as a player, and he was just a machine. I mean, look at the guy now. He's still
a machine, dude.
He's still jacked. But like, I love when you get clips of him talking to the team, and he can't sit still. He's just
but he's like running around. He's doing his thing. It's like, fuck yeah.
Yeah, he said last week when Kuznetsov scored, he was like, Kuzi, I used to hate that bird thing. I love it now, man. Because he scored, you know.
Yeah, that's hilarious.
He's an intense human.
I mean, I love that guy.
Yeah, I love watching clips too.
Riles and I were fortunate enough to grab lunch with you. Two years ago, when you were in Arizona. How did, like, I know the team wasn't that great, but did you guys enjoy yourself out there?
Yeah, for sure. I mean, I told you guys, like, just living there is just a whole different world, man. It's just, it's awesome. I mean, it makes you forget a little bit about like the whole hockey situation, the sense of, you know, you're not the best team, you know, every night. But just our time, Gene and I's time in Arizona, it was awesome. I mean, we made some great friends in the sense, and, you know, it allowed me to get my career back on track from leaving Philly to going there and, you know, just finding my game. you know, I'm forever thankful for them for giving me that opportunity, in the sense that, you know, like I said, I got my legs back, got my confidence back, in the sense I could play this game. And, you know, they're making strides right now. I mean, yeah. I don't know on the ice, but I don't know about the whole arena thing, but,
yeah,
you know, I'm happy for those guys, in the sense that, you know, they're getting a little more competitive, and those guys who have been there a while deserve that.
Yeah. Yeah. They do. They compete, that team. Like, we've talked about them quite a bit, and Arizona is nice.
Yeah.
Especially in the winter. Cool.
Yeah. So it's a little nice. Different animal. Detroit.
Yeah. I'm still pissed though. He got traded. I feel like I wasn't happy about that, but I'm not a GM. Yeah. I'm not a GM.
Yeah. Everybody
happens for a reason.
Yeah. Exactly.
Yeah. You're right. You're right. And like you said, you got yourself, I felt like the guy that was here kind of like took that swagger away from me a little bit. Like, you know, the guy that was coaching, and, I'm glad you got there. And I know we were always talking about on the show, like you played great there. So maybe you're right. Things do. I've learned that things happen for a reason. So, it was pretty cool.
How was your mindset there towards the end of your time in Philly? Like, I know it obviously gets stressful, and there's, you know, the pressure and the performance elements, like, you know, like, sports is tough enough as it is. And then you just get this another layer of pressure on top of it. Like, I mean, how difficult was it to kind of go through that ending for you in Philly?
Yeah. I mean, definitely from where it started on such a high, you know, my rookie year and whatnot, and, you know, making playoffs, and then, you know, ending on a sour note, pretty much getting traded for a used puck bag. But, you know, I mean, it sucks. I mean, it's part of the business, but, you know, for me personally, you know, I wasn't 100% like body wise. I had a lot of injuries, especially in those last couple years in Philly. And I felt like I was just turning a corner, actually. But, you know, everything happens for a reason. Like I said, I mean, can't play, you know, I thought Claude Drew was going to be a Flyer forever. You know, he's played on
true
teams since then. So it's like, just, it's the nature of the beast. You know, I really enjoyed my time in Philly. You know, I started as a young man and I became a man in that city. So I'll be forever grateful for my times there. You know, there's nothing like playing in Philly, and you can only experience that if you played there. So just in the sense of, you know, obviously the town, just living there, and then just being engulfed in, you know, the whole fan base and how passionate they are. But yeah, I mean, like I said, the last couple of years was definitely a little sour, in the sense that, you know, I couldn't really play my game, like you said, Nasty. And, you know, it's a what have you done for me lately league. And, you know, I had a couple bad years. So, you know, obviously sometimes you need to change the scenery, and that happens. And, you know, thankfully I was blessed with an opportunity in Arizona and to find my game. And, you know, it's kind of nice to prove some people wrong, for sure. But
You
know, obviously you wish you could have, you know, just stuck it out and prove people wrong there. But, you know, it happens for a reason. But definitely thankful for my time in Philly and everything that, you know, happened there.
Yeah. That era when you were here, like, it was such a good group too.
Unreal.
Raffy, Jakey, Simmer, G, like, this guy, we could go on and on, but like, it was even the years that we didn't make the playoffs, it was still like so much fun. And,
yeah, it was a great group.
You guys played hard. Like, who would you, who's, well, I probably know the answer, but who's like, one of your favorite or funny, who's like one of your funniest guys you felt like with the Flyers?
I mean, I love Lots, obviously, like, that's for life, but, you know, Raffy, but you know, you can't say about funny and charisma without Jakey. I mean, he's one of one. He's one of one, man. He's one of those 0.001% or just the way.
Yeah.
His life, he does his thing, he doesn't give a fuck, and he just rolls, man. He's awesome.
God, the three you just mentioned, Jake, Raff, and Lots, sat beside each other, and it just every day you can just sit there and watch them and listen to
the show.
It was a shit show.
Yeah.
Shit show. And like he says, like, Jake says shit you shouldn't say.
Yeah. Jake says everything that everyone's thinking.
Exactly. Which, you know, not politically correct sometimes, but everybody knows it's Jakey, and that's Jakey. So we just saw Jakey a few weeks ago. He was here and came in, and we got to see him. We had him on the show again. But those teams, man, I had a really good time with you guys. It was awesome.
Yeah. I almost wish I could like play there like as old as I am now, like now. So
yeah,
like I was so young at those times. It was like I was 21 to 27.
Yeah.
Like I wish I could play there when I was like 30 to 35, you know. It's just like it's a different experience, but with the same group somehow.
Yeah, for sure.
Bring that wisdom.
Well, the big Sim Daddy's coming in next week.
Next 13th.
There they are.
Yeah, their dogs are running around somewhere.
He's going to retire as a Flyer, and going to have a big night for Simmer, so that's going to be awesome.
One-day contract.
Yeah.
He deserves. How much are you making that one day?
That's cool, though, man. Like, Simmer was obviously there from my rookie year to when he left, and he was the man, just in the sense that, like, a little cliche, but, like, the epitome of a Flyer. I mean, hands down, like, just a beast. I mean, he was my net front god. he would take everything and anything and, you know, do our thing on the power play. And, you know, happy he's getting sent off like that. I mean, he deserves that.
Yeah, I'm so
excited. We've actually, a bunch of people have said that, like, I hope they bring him back. And that's like, they have to, man. You said, he's a Flyer.
Yeah.
He was born to be a Flyer.
For sure.
Yeah, it would have been a shame for the way it went down in Toronto there to just like let that go the way it was, where it landed up, you know. But thank God they're doing something.
They're gonna do something huge for him, I'm sure.
Yeah, happy for him.
Yeah. Quickly, also, just gonna you touched on like Roddy. How did you like Hack, like playing for Dave Hakstol?
Yeah, Hack was great. Just like different animal now. Like as I could see it as being a veteran now. Like I was a rookie when he was a rookie pretty much. And I'm sure he'll say the same similar thing in the sense that he's learned so much as he's been in the NHL for that long now and just how it is. But you know, I enjoyed my time with Hack. I mean, he had to have the hard conversations with me because I was a rookie and I was young, and he tried to point me in the right direction in the sense that, you know, like, hey, every play doesn't have to be a home run. Just do your thing. And you know, you're a dynamic player and we need you to be a dynamic player. But just in general, I think, he was a great coach. So, you know, I enjoyed him in the sense that he was also a really good person. I think everyone was. So, and it shows in his teams now. You know, Seattle's having maybe not the best year this year, but the success they had and with the team they had, it's good to see.
Yeah. Riley and I went out to one of our sponsors, Fans of Philly. They take us on a couple trips every year. We went out the van last year and we got to watch their practice. You talk about a fast practice. Well, holy fuck.
Seattle's right.
Yeah. It's Seattle. Yeah. What did I say?
It's in van. But
we did go to van. Yeah. Sorry. We're in Seattle and van, but we went to their practice, got to see Hack, and actually they pumped the Flyers pretty good.
That night.
I think the Flyers had one shot in the first period. It was a tough night.
They're like a weird team, man. They're good somehow.
Yeah.
You got a good blend.
Ghost, you know, now that you're a wily old vet, you know, and knowing that you're the dynamic player that you are, like, if you were to look back, like, coaching yourself, like, you talk about Hack coaching you, and talk about how you would coach yourself, you know, knowing the ability that you have, right, and that fine line of giving the player the luxury to make plays and be creative without holding them back and suppressing their creativity.
Yeah, I mean, I think for me, just being a different kind of defenseman, you know, obviously I'm an offensive defenseman and, you know, I'm not the best at defense. I think you just got to let people play their game. I mean, they're special and they're in this league for a reason. I think I'm not saying they didn't let me do that, but there were certain times where there was people in my ear saying like, hey, like, just be simple, just do this. And I'm like, well, that doesn't make me special. I need to be what made me special in the sense that what got me here and why I'm a different player, a dynamic player. And I think as I get older and realize that maybe simple plays are better, maybe a home run every play isn't what I need, but, you know, a shot fake as the last guy. And when people aren't expecting you to shot fake and you get around that guy, it creates offense and it's just different in that sense. So I think for me, if I had to tell my younger self, it's just you need to mature your game in the sense that you need to know when to go, when not to go, when to, you know, press that button to, you know, do something special and maybe not force it as much. And sometimes when you're young, you get in your own mind in the sense that, you know, oh, I'm not supposed to do it here. No, it's now. And that comes to that confidence issue of, you know, when to do it. So mm-hmm. I think for myself, just, you know, obviously just tell that younger guy, just, hey, play your game, do it special, but, you know, stay within yourself.
Yeah, that's good advice. Because I remember coaching you, and, you know, it's like, again, you're a dynamic player. It's like, I just want to, like, you know, get out there and do your thing, you know? It's like,
yeah.
Because, like, you need to learn the pro game. You need to get out there. You need to feel like the coaches have confidence in you. I couldn't imagine being a type of player you were and having that in the back of your mind. Like,
yeah, I mean,
guessing it's just yourself, like, all the time.
Almost like they have to let you make the mistakes so you learn, you know?
Yeah, for sure.
It's like you learn by, you know, experience. I mean, like, I remember one time, it was like random time, but it was my rookie year. We were playing in Dallas on the road, and it was a 6-on-5, and like there was like 20 seconds left, and I just turned around, and like the puck went out, and I turned around and I just tried to shoot it right away. And I remember G like stopped me off the bus. He's like, hey man, like, I know what you're trying to do there, but like, we have time, like, just settle down. Like, you don't have to make that play right there. Just settle down and make a pass, and we'll find that next play. And I was like, yeah, you're right. And, you know, from this time, I still think about that moment in the sense that, like, hey, we got time, like, poise, like, you don't have to rush it. Just, like, chill, and we'll find that next play.
Yeah.
He's pretty good.
Yeah. Right. Yeah. He's not pretty bad. Good advice. Patience, right? Yeah.
not bad.
What I was saying earlier, Ghost, like, one of my favorite things with you, well, I love
the shimmy, the pump.
I love that shit, but I've never seen guys, a player keep a puck in a zone as creatively as you. I swear, I love that stuff. Dude, I remember you, you've done it more than once, but remember you one time jumping up, catching the puck, but putting it through your legs when you put it back down because the guy was coming this way, and then going, and the guy goes flying by, and I'm like,
probably a little legal, but it's all
that
good.
That is sick, man. I used to love it.
You don't
that
do shit. That in men's league, Nas?
I can't.
You don't keep pucks in?
No, I don't keep pucks in. I get out of the way if they're coming near me, man. I don't want to get hit by one. But, yeah, no, you're definitely a special player. And that's kind of what I was alluding to there when your last year and a half here, I don't feel like they were giving you that freedom or the confidence, really. Like, you know, taking your confidence away a little bit. But you got it back, bro. You got it back.
Have to go to AZ if I can hang out in the sun.
Yeah.
Get confidence back.
I had to go find it.
Yeah. I remember working with Terry Murray, and he always talked about guys sitting in his office, like, talking about confidence.
Yeah.
He's like, I don't got no confidence. And then, you know, Murph would write on this little piece of paper. He wrote the word confidence and slide it back over to him.
He would give it to him.
What do you want me to do? He's like, I can't help you with that. It's like, that's fun. You gotta find that within you, and then I can play you more, you know. But it's obviously a struggle that everybody goes through, right? It's like,
yeah,
shit's not going well. Yeah, you know, you're all over yourself, you're in your own head. It's hard to create.
Ghost, how many times did people say you should be a forward?
Oh, dude, I played forward like 2 games ago. How crazy is that?
No, you didn't.
So Kaner,
how did I not know that?
Kaner, I had to play for one period. I played one period. I played forward.
Oh,
we went 11-7 because two forwards got sick. And our coach came in between the second and third. He goes, hey, you're going to play forward. Ghost's going to play forward. And everyone looks at me. I'm like,
yeah.
What?
I just looked at everyone. I was like, hey, I have no idea what I'm doing. So get off me.
No way. I can't believe I didn't know. I didn't see that.
I did pretty good. I swear. Did you? Like, we had some scary chances. It was against Carolina, too. Like, the hardest pinching.
Oh,
like,
I was going to say, that's tough.
Yeah.
That's awesome.
Carolina guys, I'm lining up at forward, and they're like, I'm right by the bench. Like, what the fuck's going on?
Running a face-off play.
I'm like, I don't know, boys. Swiss Army knife.
Yeah, right? That's
Jack awesome, of all trades.
That's awesome.
No, yeah, but people said that, like, my whole life. I used to be a forward when I was little, but,
yeah,
you know, I think Ray Shepard told me, he's like, hey, you know, you can still play forward. Just play defense, too. I was like, okay.
Just mix a little D. You're good.
Yeah.
Get more ice time. You got the puck on your
exactly.
stick.
Yeah,
exactly.
You know?
No, it's been said before, but a little annoying. I mean, I love being a defenseman, just playing defense.
Yeah, no, I hear you. Well, Ghost, listen, man. Good luck on this run, brother.
Mm-hmm.
Love to see you guys get in. I hope the Flyers get in too. I don't know if that's possible if both can get in, but I'd love to see you guys get in. We appreciate your time, man. I know it's a busy time of year. And
thanks, boys. Appreciate it.
Yeah, man. Miss you, buddy.
Miss you guys too. Hopefully you get down there this summer, hang out or something.
Yeah, that'd be awesome, man. And LV wanted to make sure Miss Gina knows that he's
I'll let her know.
Saying hello.
Sliding their DMs.
Yeah, you better believe I've waited for that. I have to check it every night when he goes to sleep. I have to go through that thing. I don't know where he gets it.
Yeah.
No idea.
No clue. But seriously, thanks for your time, brother. Appreciate you, man.
Thanks, guys. Appreciate
thanks,
you.
Ghost. All right, appreciate brother. Big thank you to Ghost. Shayne Gostisbehere, hopping on.
Shifty Ghost.
Oh, man.
Love the that pump guy. Fake. Love that guy, man.
Pump fake.
Never seen a guy keep a puck in his zone like him, man. Jeez. So many different ways.
Yeah.
Appreciate it, man. They're going down the stretch. They got a couple days off here, so it's nice he could join us.
Mm-hmm.
Appreciate you, brother.
Yeah. Good dude.
Yes.
Miss him.
Yeah, and Elvis misses, as we said, Gina, his wife. He really misses her.
Yeah, I'm sure. He's lonely.
He is lonely. He misses her.
Until next year.
Exactly.
Well, it's that time.
It is. Is it that time?
Yeah, I'm excited.
Ballers, at that time? Clear questions.
Never seen you so excited.
I love clear questions, and I love clear rum.
I know you do.
Clear questions brought to you by Clear Rum. Go to clearrum.com/shop. Put in Nasty 2023 and get 35% off your order.
Whew.
PA residents only. Do it. Hydrate while you dehydrate, as Riggs would say, but I feel great when I drink them.
I can tell you.
I did. I'm hydrated.
You ready to rock?
I'm ready to go. Baller, right, baller, what do we got?
Real Sean Combs over on Twitter's batting leadoff for us today.
Oh, Combsy Poo. Combsy I know Poo's that in some guy. Trouble. Oh, boy.
Need some hot water,
Not
Combsy.
That one. That's a different one. Not you.
He asks over on Twitter, with all the famous celebrities and whatnot that attend games, has any one person floored either Riles or Nasty in the fact that, holy cow, I can't believe I just met so-and-so?
Good question.
That's actually a really good question. And I feel like...
Who's up there for you, Nasty?
For me, actually, meeting LL Cool J.
Oh, yeah.
And The Rock. Those were...
Oh, The Rock, yeah.
That was
cool.
Really, really cool. I didn't get to meet this guy... But I remember in warm-ups in MSG one night, turning around. Sorry for the glitch. You see Baller's face.
It was definitely in the glitch.
De Niro. I remember turning around and just looking, and there's Robert De Niro, and I'm like, oh, my God, I want to. I know if I probably tried to walk up to him, they would stop me, but I could stop. I just was like looking at the guy. I'm like, I can't believe.
What'd you say?
I didn't say anything. I was on the bench, but I was just like, it was crazy. And there was another time where Spike Lee, I got to meet him. Okay. He wanted to say hi to Ray Emery.
Oh, cool.
Razor was in the playoffs when Chief was coaching us. But yeah, I think getting to actually talk to LL Cool J, who it was kind of funny because some of the guys on the team are like, oh, he's an actor. I'm like, oh, he was a rapper first when I was a kid. Like, he's a big time rapper. Obviously, he does it all, but that was really cool. And meeting The Rock, and he was just like, awesome. He was so down to earth. He actually stood there for about 15 minutes to talk to me and Harry the one day in LA. It was really cool. Yeah, it was really cool. I think those stand out the most.
Yeah, some good ones. I'm trying to think. Well, smoking with Snoop Dogg was pretty neat.
Meeting Snoop was cool, too. Yeah.
I mean, I grew up listening to Snoop and followed Snoop. For sure. So I know he's... I mean, you could throw him up there as an A-lister.
Snoop's an A-lister,
for sure. You know, you think of Snoop as, like, you think of his gangster rap, but how much he's done for, you know, humanity. He's done a lot of cool stuff, and, you know, he just keeps doing it.
Yeah.
So, that you know, Snoop was cool. You know, Kings of Leon actually hanging out before you were there,
I
think, right?
Yeah, I was there.
Hanging out with them before, just good guys, just, you know. Trying to think who else. Some wrestlers in there. Rob Zombie, Ozzy Osbourne.
Met Rob Zombie, You met Ozzy?
Well, briefly, walking by in his little wizard outfit on going out to the stage.
Remember when he was hopping? You couldn't stop laughing. Yeah. You just couldn't stop laughing.
Quick little hello, Goo Goo Dolls.
Yeah.
Little Bon Jovi.
Yeah, Bon Jovi.
Yeah, I guess mostly musicians. But
Buck Cherry for me.
Oh, Buck,
they're probably not A-list, but they're one of my faves.
Yeah.
Phil Demmel.
Oh,
he's an absolute rock star.
Machine Head.
Yeah. Lot. We've been fortunate.
Yeah.
Very fortunate. But that's a great question. Some
Sendog, yeah, Cypress Hill.
Yeah, Sendog, our boy Sendog, dude. I'm not going to lie, though. Got on that bus the one time. I thought I was on Pluto by the time I got off.
Yeah, I guess so.
I felt like I was floating.
They're puffing on the premium, Nast.
One of my really good friends, Billy Wilson, his son, Weston, is with the Phillies. I think he's in Lehigh right now. But I took him to see Sendog, and it was just secondhand. And we were in one.
Oh, I bet.
We were in one. But it's a great question. Yeah, mm-hmm. I've been fortunate enough to meet a lot of cool people.
We got Jake Van Ripper 27 over on Instagram.
Ripsy.
He asked, why is fighting important in today's game? I loved it in the 70s, 80s, and 90s, but now it is so staged and no factor on the playing of the game and bare fist hitting visors, ? I miss the Hospodars, the Tockets, Berubis, and even the host of the show. If fighting can stay, how do we make it a better product? If not, let's protect the dental and put full masks on. P.S. Who fights in the playoffs?
Wow.
Okay, timeout. It's way less staged now than it used to be. Now, Rempe coming in kind of had some staged aspects to the fights because he's a new big guy in the heavyweights. I do get what you're saying there. That's a good question, but I feel like it's not nearly as staged as even when you played. I mean, I don't want to say it was staged, but you knew.
Yeah, it was a lot more staged fights.
You were going to fight. Probably fight Brash. You're probably going to fight LaRocque. You're probably going to fight McGrath. Right. And all the guys you fought,
mm-hmm.
you probably were going to have to.
Yeah.
Nowadays, I think sometimes, like we've talked about this as well, like a big hit, everybody wants to fight all of a sudden. Truba crushes guys. I kind of like the fact that teammates go to take up, but some people argue that, well, it's a clean hit. Like, live with it.
You still took a run at your player.
You still took a run at your player, and I don't have a problem with it. And
I don't either.
Ever see people in their seats when there's a fight.
No.
But I don't think it's staged like you said. And unfortunately, the visor thing is just what it is. Yeah. I mean,
I think the reality is these guys are trying to play within the rules, right? Take the instigator rule out. Then you'll see some spontaneous fights, right? I mean, we've been arguing for that for years and years and years, you know? So the staged fights were just a byproduct of stupid rules. You know, you want to introduce visors? Well, but you guys have to work around them. You got to peel off the helmet. You got to work underneath the visor. Yeah, yeah. I mean, punching the visor is not ideal. Punching the helmet's not ideal, but you know, you can't take helmets off like you used to, you know, and square off. So guys are just trying to do what they can do within the rules. Obviously, the skill level is through the roof, and there's less and less guys. Well, there's no guys like myself, right? One-dimensional fighters. You got guys like Delorier that can skate pretty damn good in a straight line. Rempe, obviously, he's good enough that Lavi's believing in him.
Yep.
You know, Reeves is kind of on his way out. But, like, few guys. But you got to be able to play. And it's hard to find a skilled enough guy that can fight like that and is willing to fight like that. That's, you know, that can contribute offensively. So the game has changed a lot, and it's no longer the Broad Street Bullies. You can no longer have line brawls. You can no longer, have five for fighting. When someone gets blown up, it's always an instigator. There's always extra penalties. So, you don't want to put your teammates down. So a lot's changed, and it's going to continue to evolve or pushing the fighting out. But, I mean, big hit. I have no problem with guys going after a guy, even if it's a clean hit.
Right.
It just shows that you care. It shows that you're defending your teammate. You don't have to sit there and analyze and say, ooh, that was a clean hit, so I'm just going to, let this one go.
Right.
And, show up and, get 100%. Your hands dirty. I mean, the team responds to that kind of behavior. So, it's never going back to the way it was, and it's going to be, probably less and less fighting as this thing maneuvers forward.
Well, but, I don't think ever you want to go to an NHL game where everyone's wearing full
eyes. No, you don't want that.
Or a bubble or a cage, then everybody's tough, right?
I think that's when I stopped watching hockey completely. Yeah. I wouldn't watch the highlights now because it would be just like, hey, you sign up for the big boy sports, right? I mean, I know it's not like this anymore, but growing up wanting to get out of junior so I can take the visor off.
Yeah.
Because you're a pro, right? And I get it. Like, the sticks and pucks and, no one wants to lose an eye, but there was something like you signed up for the sport, and there's consequences. I do appreciate them protecting the players, but I still believe in personal choice, which we don't have much of anymore, right? I mean, so, but I also understand the insurance piece and liability and, you know, sewing up someone's eye, you know, or replacing someone's eye is probably not a good look.
Right.
When we could have maybe protected it. So, but if we go to full bubbles, I mean, to me, it's like,
you're losing a lot.
You're going to lose a lot of credence there. So,
yeah, I don't think anyone wants that.
No.
One more. DMBTour05 is on Twitter talking about the Flyers. Do you think this team and players can step up and meet the challenge and make the playoffs?
I think so.
I hope so. I think so. I know the one thing you can't, and we've talked about this, say about this team is that they're not giving it everything they have night. They really do, and I hope they've worked so hard all year. And I know you got, you know, it's got to be all 82 games, which, I mean, there haven't been many nights where we've said they just look like they, you know, what they look like the last week was that they're almost out of gas.
Yeah.
And going back to what we said earlier, Torts has even said, like, it's hard to practice because you want these guys to be fresh and all this. So I hope they can. I believe they can do it. Like you said, this weekend's going to be huge. Like, all these games left are huge. But I hope they can get in there and get some really good experience for these young guys, you know?
Yeah, agreed. And I think if you look at their games, they're resilient, as you mentioned, right? Third period, full court presses. Yep. So you'd like to think it's beyond the back nine. It's like you're down to this last, six games of the year that they're going to approach these games like they approach the third period of these games. They're down or whatnot, right? I can't see them stop fighting at this point. I mean, they're not going to stop fighting. Are they running out of gas? I mean, I don't think they're running out of gas. I think maybe they just hit a little skid, you know?
Yeah.
Just a few bad days at the office. You'd like to think that they're going to bounce back and come back fresh. They had a few days off.
Yeah.
Got a couple practices in.
Yeah.
And they know what's at stake, so.
Yeah, for sure.
Bring the A game.
Let's go.
That's a wrap.
That's a wrap.
Clear questions in the books.
152 in the books.
Oof.
Wow.
Can you believe that?
Nope. Still can't.
Trying to wrap my head around it.
I'm trying to wrap my head around it too. And the drums.
And the drums, yeah.
We'll have to throw that one up, Baller, when you get a second there. We're trying to wrap our heads around that one for sure.
Just birthing a drum nest.
I know that. Elk skin.
A little elk skin.
Elk skin nest. It's sitting. It's not ready. You got to bring it in, and I'll just pick and grin, and you can just pop that thing.
Let's do it. You're all about it. You love the drum nest.
I love it.
You're a little jealous. A little jelly.
Scare me a little bit.
jelly nest.
I don't know, man.
All right.
Yeah, I love grape
jelly.
We're
going to have to do a little drum workshop.
We will.
Get you into it.
Get me into it.
Educate you on it.
All right.
What's going on with it?
All right. You're in one.
All right, knuckleheads. Until next week for 153, be sure to subscribe on our YouTube channel. Like, comment, questions, Instagram, Twitter, whatever else, NAS, everything.
Everything. Every platform. We appreciate all of you.
Appreciate your support. Until next week, stay safe.
See ya.